Praise the Lord, everyone.
Praise the Lord.
Okay, we'll get started here. I did get a chance to talk to my sister several times, and the greatest thing that's happened is that she is showing signs of going back to somewhat. The stroke that she had, they said, is one that's kind of irreversible. There's not much hope in it, but shockingly, as they said, that some parts of her have worked well, and that's her eyesight is getting better, and she's able to move much more. This is the thing that she's asking request for us, so we'll bring this before the Lord, is they still have not okayed her to go to that Mary and Joy Hospital. And she's saying just keep her in mind and prayer for that, because the doctor told her this would be the therapy that would work, because she'd constantly be in therapy with them, versus in a nursing home they'd come in every other hour or whatever. And so let's keep her in prayer for that. And then Brother Dan, his daughter's down in that mess. Brother Highsmith's sister's down there in Dallas, around Texas, in that area they got hit. So there's several here that they're got family members, so we'll bring that up in prayer. And that's that one that lives South Texas, right?
But his wife is 97, and if she fell, she needs prayer.
Okay.
Michael's not paid to go well, but he's still pretty good. They still live in their own home.
That's incredible.
Almost 100 years
old. Yeah, Brother Highsmith was asking for prayer for his uncle. I know that he got an opportunity to finally see him. It's been a length of time, but anyway, he's going to be 100 years old. His wife's 97, and she fell, and this is who we're praying for tonight. So if God wants them to be in their hundreds, the woman that just they talked to just recently was 104, and she's fine. She's fine, and so they gave her a shot, you know, not an alcoholic shot, but a shot for the coronavirus. So she said, okay. She said, took it. But okay, we're praying for Brother Highsmith. That would be his aunt then. Anybody else? Anybody else?
My grandmother said that her shoulder was bothering her. And then my aunt she's had her last radiation treatment, and she's on the road to recovery, but it's her, the actually exposing her to radiation, like she's actually got like, it looks like third-degree burns. There's actually blisters on her skin, and it's turned black in areas. So I know that there's struggle with pain and all of that with there too. So just pray that the Lord will just speed her recovery along, and she'll be able to walk just whole again.
Okay. Yeah, that's a big task. So Brother Matthew was talking about his aunt again, the one that's went through all these radiation treatments. This is her last one, and it doesn't look good, meaning what it looks like after having the treatments, but he's hoping that this will be it, that it'll everything will reverse and she can start the healing. And this is where we lean on God. So we'll bring, and then Sister Downing, her shoulder's been bothering her, so we'll bring her up in prayer. So anybody else? Anybody else? Okay. How many unspoken requests? Okay. Let's take all this for the Lord. Precious Savior, I'll look at the ones that are in health-wise. I do continue to pray and bring it up before the church, my older sister, Laura, that they will allow her to go into this special hospital. It's necessary she goes through certain therapy, and this is the place that seems to be that will work with her on this. So, Lord, I just pray that you might bend the hearts of the people there, that somehow she'll be on that list, and she'll be able to go over there, Lord. We thank you. She's mentioned several healings she's had, which seemed very impossible at the beginning with the doctors, and that's proven to be different. So we thank you for that, Lord. Now, Lord, for others that health reasons why, we bring up Brother Matthew's aunt. Lord, this is her last treatment. And Lord, you know what she's went through, and it's a big thing, emotionally, somewhat degrading, a lot of things I can only imagine that you hear about what people go through. So Lord, I just pray that as she has turned to you and her family, that Lord, you would touch her And Lord, just bring her all the way through. Lord, let her find that truly that it was by your Holy Spirit, by your hand, Lord, that's touched her and made this all possible. Lord, we ask even for Sister Downing with her shoulder that's been bothering. I know she has other ailments too. So, Lord, I just look at you that you give her, Lord, comfort. Touch these areas that seems to be a major problem with her. Lord, that it robs her of sleep and robs her of just feeling good. So, Lord, if you would be, Lord, so merciful just to touch these needs here. Now, Lord, we look at those that are in Texas that are going through, Brother Dan's daughter, Brother Heisman's family, and then also, Lord, for his aunt, the one that is 97, that you would touch her. Lord, and I just am so thankful, Lord, that someone could live so many years, Lord, in their own home and still have a husband, still have a wife, and have that companionship, and Lord, have you there first, the focus of everything. So, Lord, I just pray that you continue to strengthen their bodies, have them, as they went through many other things, have them to go through this, Lord, in the same way, thanking you, Lord, giving you all the credit for the impossible. Now, Lord, we've seen such a great show of hands for unspoken requests. Well, Lord, I just pray that you'll take each and every one of them. And Lord, everyone feel that unction of the Holy Spirit to know that, Lord, that we have confidence when we bring this before you, that, Lord, you will answer these things. Lord, you've watched over us in this terrible weather we've had, and we still got a little bit left, but Lord, we continue to look to you, Lord, to watch over not only us physically, we could easily slip or fall, but Lord, vehicles might not start, or just the cold that gives all these other germs and everything else. So, Lord, watch over each one of the saints. Now, Lord, as we turn to why we're here, Lord, why we gather in your name, why we gather with that kind of spirit of fellowship, Lord, that you'll bless, Lord, the word tonight. Lord, bless and anoint our watchman. Lord, allow him to say the very things that Lord, that as he searches in his mind, that you'll, Lord, enhance his thoughts with your word and allow each ear to have that itch, to have that desire, to want to hear every bit of it. And Lord, bring it that they can understand it and feel that it's wonderful, Lord, as we know that your book in this hour has so much secrecy. It's to a people that you've chosen to be your bride. So, Lord, again, we bring all these things up for you. Help us with our song service, Lord. And again, we just thank you for being here. We ask in your name, in the precious name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. Brother Matthew.
We'll sing out of the blue books. I don't know where it is in the blue book. This song came to mind, so.
Thanks I give you.
Here's my cup, Lord.
this song just popped in and then popped right out, just as that fast. It's like the Pontius Pitfill or whatever that popped up and saw a shadow and went back in. It was just like that. What else? Let's do let's do 220. Yeah, it just was right there and it popped right out, huh? I think I do it in D. I remember the key, I can't remember the song. 220 in the blue book.
When with the Savior we enter the glory land, won't it be wonderful there? And did the troubles and cares of the story land, won't it be wonderful there? Oh, won't it be wonderful there? Having no burdens to bear, joyously singing with heart bells all ringing, oh, won't it be wonderful there? Walking and talking with Christ the Supernal One, won't it be wonderful there? Praising, adoring the matchless Eternal One, won't it be wonderful there? Oh, won't it be wonderful there? Having no burdens to bear, joyously singing with heart bells all ringing, oh, won't it be wonderful there? There where the tempest will never be sweeping us, won't it be wonderful there? Sure that forever the Lord will be keeping us, won't it be wonderful there? Oh, won't it be wonderful there? Having no burdens to bear, joyously singing with heart bells all ringing, oh, won't it be wonderful there? Oh, won't it be wonderful there? Having no burdens to bear, joyously singing with heart bells all ringing, oh, won't it be wonderful there?
Oh, it was I Would Not Be Denied, but I think that's in the red book. Let's grab the red book. Thank you. You know what? I was just, I think it's just on my mind because I had a thought that came to my head while I was driving in the car, and then I got here and I saw Brother Brad's text message, and then I kind of got caught up with setting up and everything, but I was thinking about Judges. Let me just read it real quick. In Judges 6:11, it's Gideon, and I hadn't actually read this yet. I was just put it up so I could read it later when I had a minute, but it says, "And there came an angel of the Lord and sat under an oak, which was in Ophrah, that pertained unto Joash the Abizrite, and his son Gideon, threshed wheat by the winepress to hide it from the Midianites." You guys all know the story, right? Midianites didn't like him too much. "And the angel of the Lord appeared unto him and said unto him, The Lord is with thee, thou mighty man of valor." I think that this is what I was feeling a couple of weeks ago, brother. "And Gideon said unto him, O my Lord, if the Lord be with us, Why then is all this befallen us? And where be all his miracles which our fathers told us of, saying, Did not the Lord bring us up from Egypt? But now the Lord hath forsaken us and delivered us into the hands of the Democrats or the Midianites. And the Lord looked upon him and said, Go in thy might, and thou shalt save Israel from the hand of the Midianites. Have I not sent thee? And he said unto him, O my Lord, wherewith shall I save Israel? Behold, my family is poor in Manasseh, and I am least in my father's house. And the Lord said unto him, Surely I will be with thee. I can feel it, right? And thou shalt smite the Midianites as one man. One man is going to take them all on. It doesn't take much. There's a great song that God doesn't need a mighty army, and he doesn't need a whole bunch of things. He just needs a few good men, and it only takes just a few. And he said unto him, Now if I found grace in thy sight, then show me a sign that thou talkest with me. And it goes on, but I maybe that's why this song popped into my head. I would not be denied. Sometimes the word of God is 100% true, right? I mean, we're all here. Otherwise, what are we standing here for if you don't believe it? But if those promises that he made are in there and I don't have it yet, am I willing to wrestle for it? Am I willing to continue on anyway, believing that it is still mine? It is my birthright. I'm going to claim victory over it, right? And that was the point of what I was trying to say before. 19, I would not be denied. If you're not where, if you don't have what you've been promised, if God's told you that you have a promise, like Sister Kathy, she doesn't believe where she is where she's supposed to be. And I don't either. I would say it's worth wrestling an angel for, right? It's worth it to go through whatever the enemy has to throw at us with fiery darts and all, to just make it through, just stand, like he says, and get through. When pangs of death seized on my soul, unto the Lord I cried, till Jesus came and made me whole, I would not be denied.
Not be denied.
We already are. Okay. We'll go ahead and turn it over to Brother Rojas. God bless you, brother.
Thank you for the water. All right, praise the Lord, brothers and sisters. Take a seat. We're just a few here today. But God is here. I know that. Hope everyone's been enjoying the snow. Normally, we get snow and we're out sledding, but for understandable reasons, we haven't done that. It's just hard to be outside too long. But I have my theories about the snow. All right. I want to change it a little bit. It's still, in a way, related to Elijah, but we're going to start here in a different place. Titled this message, Hearing the Voice of God. And the reason is, brothers and sisters, that if we're the children of God, brothers and sisters, we should be able to hear His voice, and we look forward to when we can hear the voice of God. We're always anticipating hearing His voice. It is something that, you know, we hear. And let's just, because I know that it is a question in some people's minds, brothers and sisters, especially when you are new to the Lord, you hear testimonies about some of the brothers and sisters, hear their testimonies about the Lord speaking to them, about how the Lord helped them deal with the situation by in giving instruction in some way, you know, don't do this or do that, and usually God doesn't have long conversations. He just has just little sentence, you know, answers, very, very short usually. But you hear these things, brothers and sisters, as a new believer, and I know that we don't have a lot of new believers here. We have veterans. But I know that there are still those brothers and sisters that can benefit from these things. And so we're going to address them. And hopefully there's something in there, brothers and sisters, that everyone can benefit from. But the question, brothers and sisters, that we pose is, when we hear these testimonies, is, Lord, I would like to hear your voice, just like I hear that these people hear your voice, right? It's a good desire to have. It's to hear the voice of God, brothers and sisters. You know, what child doesn't want to hear the voice of a parent or of a father? Just to feel. I mean, some kids sleep and they kind of just feel around. They want to make sure they can feel someone there next to them, right? They don't even open their eyes. They kind of just go like that. Oh, yeah, they're there. and you feel, and they feel comforted, they feel safe, you know, and we feel the same way, brothers and sisters. We want to be able to hear his voice. We want to be able to hear a word of affirmation, of approval. All these things are wonderful things for a child to hear, brothers and sisters. They look for these moments when they hear something good coming from a parent. And so this message, brothers and sisters, is for mostly for those younger believers, right? Hearing the voice of God. Now, we may think that only they have this question, brothers and sisters, but sometimes we are in a place in our life, brothers and sisters, where we have been a little bit careless, and we don't hear the voice of God like we used to, right? And there's a reason, brothers and sisters. And deep inside, we know that there's a problem. But it's important, brothers and sisters, that we hear something like this, because we're living in a time when we need to hear the voice of God. We've always need to hear the voice of God, but we hear warning after warning, brothers and sisters, about being near to him right now. And we need to, brothers and sisters, I believe God being merciful, brothers and sisters, he has many different ways of getting our attention. Many different ways. But you know, I think of Jesus, brothers and sisters, and I don't think God ever had to say or think, you know, I can't get through to him. I'm going to have to do something else to get his attention. I don't think God, brothers and sisters, ever did that with him. But sometimes he has to do that with us. And but we want to be able to hear his voice, brothers and sisters. To be able to hear his whisper, right? No matter where we are, the first time I ever heard his voice, brothers and sisters, was about the age of my son. And it's when I realized, brothers and sisters, that God had called me for something different. And brothers and sisters, once you hear that voice, he trains you, brothers and sisters, because even that requires training. It requires you knowing and understanding. And but brothers and sisters, it's something that you look forward to. I say that again. That you want that to be. You know, I remember Brother Jackson preaching a message. I don't remember the title, but it was near the end. Being led, something like that. And because you had, I guess there must have been a problem, brothers and sisters, where people, where someone somewhere, or I don't know if it was a congregation or what, but it seemed like they were robots. God was leading them so much, it was like they had nothing to say or do by themselves. And I don't really know the inside story of all that, but I just remember that message, being led by of the Spirit, I think it was the title of the message. But he was looking at, brothers and sisters, what it was to be led of God, what it was like to yes, hear the voice of God and God dealing with you in many different ways as a Christian. And hearing the voice of God, brothers and sisters, should be a normal thing. It should not be, brothers and sisters, you know, the exception where, look at that brother, can hear the voice of God. No one else can, but he can. It should be normal. It should be every day, brothers and sisters. Not necessarily you're going to hear from him every day, but every brother, every sister that's in the Lord has, brothers and sisters, that constant communication where you can hear the word of God, you can hear the voice of God, that you're led of God, brothers and sisters. And this is not necessarily so much on being led of God, it's just hearing his voice. That's really what this is on. Let's take a look at our first scripture in Jeremiah 33:3. And some of these scriptures I really fell in love with, because sometimes you read them, but you're not necessarily looking for, digging for any information, right? You just read it, but when you're after a certain meaning, brothers and sisters, you tend to see that in a lot of scriptures. I think that's the way it always is. You find something because you're looking for it. But it says, call unto me, and I will answer thee, and show thee great and mighty things which thou knowest not. And I bring this scripture up, brothers and sisters, because he is making the invitation that we call unto him. That we, brothers and sisters, that we speak to him. That we speak to him like we speak to another person. Right? You're driving and you speak to him. And many times, brothers and sisters, it's just your thinking is directed, your thoughts are directed towards him. And you communicate, you speak to him through your thoughts, right? And God hears my thoughts, brothers and sisters. God hears your thoughts. And so he is making the invitation, brothers and sisters, that we call unto him, that we seek him, right? It says, and I will answer thee. I will answer thee. You know, sometimes you hear from people, you know, I pray, I speak to the Lord, but it feels like he doesn't hear me. Or he doesn't hear me. But brothers and sisters, I think it's not that that he doesn't hear us, is really that we don't hear him. Because he says, if you speak to me, if you look for me and call unto me, I will answer thee. So he answers our call, brothers and sisters. It can be you in a soft voice, brothers and sisters. It can be you in just a quiet thought. And he hears that. It's wonderful, brothers and sisters, that he can hear our thoughts, our prayers, whether they're spoken or unspoken, right? We say, do we have an unspoken? Yes, we have an unspoken. But then we say, but Lord, you know all about it. Because he does. And that's the kind of God that we serve, brothers and sisters. A God can answer unspoken prayers, right? We think, brother says unspoken, you know, who has an unspoken prayer, and we just think, and we mention it in our mind, this person or this need, personal need. And God knows all about it, brothers and sisters. That's the kind of God we serve. Call unto me, and I will answer thee. And what will he share with us, brothers and sisters? It's just a beautiful scripture. He says, I will show thee great and mighty things. Great and mighty things, brothers and sisters. He will tell us, brothers and sisters, things that have not even happened. He will warn us of dangers that are around the corner, brothers and sisters. Things that are impossible for us to know with our human understanding. Yet, brothers and sisters, he gives us insight into things that we have no idea. He says, I will show thee great and mighty things which thou knowest not. He reveals to you wonderful things, brothers and sisters. And usually when the Lord speaks to you, it's to give you a heads up, right? It's to give you a knowledge of a thing that you need to be aware of. And we can all remember those things. I remember many things of, like that. I remember Brother Jackson when he got to speak on the image in the book of Daniel. God had been dealing with him and told him, you'll be speaking on this. Brother Branham was sick or wasn't, I think he was sick, right? And so he had to speak that night. But God let him know that it would be required of him to do that. Many times, from just a few words, and he lets you know of things that you don't know. It says, things that thou knowest not. Well, how did you know that? Well, the Lord told me. Right? These are the things, brothers and sisters, that every believer, as a young believer, brothers and sisters, a young Christian, hearing these kinds of testimonies, you're like, Lord, I want to be able to share a testimony like that. Right? I get into trouble all the time. If you could keep me from half of those, it would be great. And he will, brothers and sisters, and he can. God's kept me from many accidents. He's kept me from many accidents, brothers and sisters. And we hear testimonies of those kinds. All right. So God is promising, brothers and sisters, that he will speak to us if we call upon him. If we speak to him, he will answer us. Because it's his desire, brothers and sisters, to be able to have a conversation with us, to have communion with us, brothers and sisters, daily communion. But not every, brothers and sisters, every young brother, young sister feels that is happening. It's not happening, perhaps, in brothers and sisters, and it's a concern. Or you've been with the Lord for a long time, brothers and sisters, and you're not hearing from the Lord like you used to hear from the Lord. And so that may apply as well here. Let's look at another scripture in the book of Psalms. It says, O come, let us worship and bow down. Let us kneel before the Lord our Maker. For He is our God, and we are the people of His pasture. If we are His people, brothers and sisters, then we should be able to speak to our Father, right? And the sheep of His hand. So look at how, brothers and sisters, He takes us and He says, you are mine. And then it says, today, if ye will hear His voice, if ye will hear His voice, look at how that works, brothers and sisters. He says, call unto me. We read that earlier in Jeremiah. Call unto me, right? And I will answer thee. I will answer thee. But then what's the problem, brothers and sisters? What does he say here in this passage? He says, if ye will hear His voice. The problem, brothers and sisters, is with hearing His voice. It's not with Him not answering us. It's that we can't hear what He says. If ye will hear the voice of God today, there is an if in front of that, brothers and sisters. There is a big if, because it's dependent on us, brothers and sisters. Not Him. He doesn't lie. He comes through, brothers and sisters, with what He said He would do. But it's like He's putting the ball back on our court, back on our side. If you will hear My voice. And that's important, brothers and sisters, because then it's up to us to try to remedy that situation. Why can I hear the voice of God? It's not that God does not hear me, but I'm not hearing God. He's the one that should be offended, right? I talk to Him, and He doesn't hear me. He doesn't hear me. And so what keeps us away from that, brothers and sisters? What keeps us from hearing the voice of God? Because God, brothers and sisters, isn't going to raise His voice. God isn't, brothers and sisters, going to try harder because we can't hear Him. He's going to send someone like me to let you know that you got to remove those cobwebs. Maybe we need some spiritual Q-tips. Right? Remove that earwax so we can hear His voice. And so that's got to mean, brothers and sisters, that there's things that get in the way. Obstacles and barriers, brothers and sisters, that keep us from hearing the word or the voice of God. And these are things that are under our control, brothers and sisters. We are required to take the appropriate actions to make sure that, as that song goes, brothers and sisters, there's nothing between me and my Savior. Nothing between. And there's obvious barriers, brothers and sisters. Such as, brothers and sisters, our lifestyle, a lifestyle of sin, guilt, brothers and sisters, because of it. No doubt, brothers and sisters, that we need to make things right with God. Right? It doesn't matter, brothers and sisters, where you are or how many years you've been a Christian, brothers and sisters. These things can happen. And I'm not saying, brothers and sisters, that they're terrible things. They don't have to be, brothers and sisters, terrible things. Okay? They don't have to be, brothers and sisters, the blackest of sins. And that's not what I'm even referring to. But brothers and sisters, these are things, brothers and sisters, that are going to be a problem. They're going to be an issue, brothers and sisters, when it comes to hearing the voice of God. Let's make things right with God, brothers and sisters. How do we do that? Let us go into the book of Psalms, chapter 32. It says, blessed is he whose transgression is forgiven, whose sin is covered. Blessed is he, and that is true, brothers and sisters. You are blessed when your sin is covered. You are blessed, brothers and sisters, when your transgression is forgiven. So we have this issue, brothers and sisters, of sin in our life. He said, blessed are you, brothers and sisters, if that sin is covered. Right? Two, it says, blessed is the man unto whom the Lord imputeth not iniquity, and in whose spirit there is no guile. No guile, brothers and sisters. Who are we going to kid? Who are we going to mock, brothers and sisters? Not him. We cannot mock the Lord. We need to be open, brothers and sisters, towards the Lord. Because he sees everything about us. In verse 3 it says, when I kept silence. And so sometimes, brothers and sisters, we keep silent. What are we supposed to do, brothers and sisters? We're supposed to speak to him, aren't we? Isn't that what he said? Didn't he say, brothers and sisters, in that first scripture that we read, call unto me and I will answer? Call unto me. But you know what, brothers and sisters? David is saying here, when I kept silent, and we keep silent, brothers and sisters, when there's sin in our life, we keep silent about it. We don't want to bring it up because we know that we're going to have to take action. We're going to have to do a little housekeeping. Sometimes we just don't want to, brothers and sisters. Look at that scripture we read in Psalms 95:7, where it says, today if ye will hear his voice. And I told the brother, I want verse 8 as well, and I didn't read it. But I'm going to read the first part of it right now. It says, harden not your heart. Harden not your heart, brothers and sisters, because we're really good at that. We're really good at saying or not saying anything when we know it's not convenient for us. In our own crooked way of thinking, it's not convenient for me. I can't admit to such a thing. Right? When I kept silence. Does that ring a bell? Maybe it's not now, but at some point in your life, that was happening to him. That was David, brothers and sisters. That was David. A man that loved God. A man that loved God, brothers and sisters, yet he says, sometimes I kept silent. And what happened when that prophet went and told him? David, you've been silent, but I'm here to tell you something. Let me tell you a story about a rich man. And you all know the story. But David had been silent about that, brothers and sisters. He just kind of just ignored it, pushed it back, hardened his heart, brothers and sisters, acted like nothing was wrong, went on with his kingly business. But God in his mercy, brothers and sisters, did something to address it. He sent his prophet. And so what does he say, brothers and sisters, here? He says in verse 3, when I kept silence, my bones waxed old through my roaring all the day long. For day and night, thy hand was heavy upon me. My moisture is turned into the drought of summer. What was happening, brothers and sisters? He had a guilty conscience. He was dealing with guilt, brothers and sisters, because of sin. And he's telling you, he's expressing, brothers and sisters, the condition of really, brothers and sisters, of his spirit. He uses my bones wax old through my roaring all the day long. It just wouldn't leave him, brothers and sisters, and it pierces all the way into your bones, right? It's heavy. He says, for day and night thy hand was heavy upon me. Yet he remains silent, brothers and sisters. It's there. It's bothering you. Yet you don't bring it up. You don't bring it up, brothers and sisters. My moisture is turned into the drought of summer. In verse 5, brothers and sisters, I acknowledge my sin unto thee. See, he's broken his silence, brothers and sisters. He has broken his silence. That's an important thing here, brothers and sisters. We're living in a day, brothers and sisters, where we need to be open with the Lord. Because the Lord, brothers and sisters, is about to do some wonderful things to his bride. He is, brothers and sisters. This country is going through things, brothers and sisters, that are not over. And you know, brothers and sisters, God never told us that we wouldn't be in the middle of it. We're going to be in the middle of George Washington's vision. We need to be able to hear his voice, brothers and sisters. And so when there is, brothers and sisters, when God is trying to get our attention, that there is something, and that Holy Spirit of God, brothers and sisters, is working on us, trying to get us to open up, we cannot remain silent. We can't afford to remain silent, brothers and sisters. Because we will be, in dangerous situations. And we want that communion with the Lord, brothers and sisters, because we want to be able to receive that knowledge that will preserve us. We want to be led of him, brothers and sisters, in the days to come. And so in verse 5, we're there. I acknowledge my sin unto thee. It says, and mine iniquity have I not hid. Let us be open. If we have wronged him, brothers and sisters, let us confess that sin. It's our responsibility, brothers and sisters, to take this necessary step. We're not going to tell him anything he doesn't already know. He's the one urging us to tell him, to confess to him what he already knows, brothers and sisters. And so David, it says that he did not hide his iniquity. I mean, he did for a while, but then he didn't. And he says, I said, I will confess my transgressions unto the Lord. And thou forgavest the iniquity of my sin. Wow. He was in a place, brothers and sisters, where he knew, brothers and sisters, that he was in this sin in his life, brothers and sisters, was keeping him from being that blessed man that he started out mentioning. Blessed is the man, he says, whose transgression is forgiven, whose sin is covered, whom the Lord does not impute sin unto him, brothers and sisters. That wasn't him. But this is a place that he was able to return to, brothers and sisters, after he dealt with that sin in his life. It's as easy as that, brothers and sisters, to restore your relationship back to the Lord. He urges us, brothers and sisters, to return to him, to confess our sin, brothers and sisters. That's what he wants from us, brothers and sisters. Let's look at 1 John chapter 1, verse 9. Here we have another if, brothers and sisters. Another if. It's up to us. If we confess our sins, it says that he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Brothers and sisters, we confess our sin, brothers and sisters. The blood of Christ, brothers and sisters, cleanses us, brothers and sisters, from all unrighteousness. That sin is not impugned unto us, as David said. And we're restored. And we're restored. It just feels so good to say it. God has made a way for us, brothers and sisters. He has made a way to restore us back unto him. And it's, we return, brothers and sisters, and we're in need of that cleansing blood, brothers and sisters, over and over. Over and over, brothers and sisters. We need his forgiveness. It's something that will keep us from, brothers and sisters, hearing his voice. We can't afford not to hear the voice of God. We can't afford, brothers and sisters, to make the mistakes that the world makes. To end up, brothers and sisters, in the same situation. calamities as they do. Because we are children of God. And we are led of God, brothers and sisters, by His Spirit. We need His Spirit. He's promised to give us His Spirit. But whether, brothers and sisters, we have a lifetime of, we'll say, of living in the world, if we just come into the Lord now, or we need God's grace, brothers and sisters, because of an instance. The blood of Christ is there. It's available. We need to be cleansed, brothers and sisters. Daily. Daily, brothers and sisters. We need to go to the cross. Lord, forgive me. And sometimes it's like that scripture. Sometimes we don't know what we do. Forgive them, for they know not what they do. Sometimes we don't know what we do, brothers and sisters, and we fall. But the Lord invites us, brothers and sisters, to come to Him. Right? The door is open. The door is open. Something else, brothers and sisters, we're looking at obstacles to hearing the voice of God. This whole message is, brothers and sisters, on hearing his voice. Hearing His voice. Let us go into the book of Mark, chapter 4, verse 18. And these are they which are sown among thorns, such as hear the word. Such as hear the word. And the cares of this world, and the deceitfulness of riches, and the lusts of other things entering in, choke the word, and it becometh unfruitful. I bring this up, brothers and sisters, because it is so easy to become distracted, brothers and sisters. It is so easy to become distracted, brothers and sisters, in this 21st century. Right? You can become distracted 24 hours a day right here. It's so easy to. And brothers and sisters, and it is a sin, and we go back to the other passage, and we have to make things right with God and confess our sin. But I thought I'd mention this as a separate thing, brothers and sisters, because we find that we're doing so many things, brothers and sisters, and that our mind is occupied and our heart is occupied with worldly things. It's not so much, brothers and sisters, about just going to work to make a living, right? To support yourself and your family, to meet their needs, brothers and sisters. It's more than that. It becomes more than that. Right? We got to remember, brothers and sisters, that we're here, but we're really not citizens of this world, brothers and sisters. We have a destination that is not of this world, brothers and sisters. And so, brothers and sisters, you know, you know, we live in a time, brothers and sisters, where parents, a lot of parents, don't have time for their children. Right? And I run into this all the time. I just don't understand how, I mean, meeting a lot of people, brothers and sisters, they have little kids, and it's like the kids live in daycare. And I just don't agree with that. If you're going to be a parent, take care of your children. They need their mom and dad. Right? Who's going to teach them, brothers and sisters? Who's going to instill values in them, brothers and sisters, if it's not mom and dad? It's going to be, you know, the daycare. It's going to be the people there. It's going to be the other kids. I think it's just a responsibility that every parent embarks on, brothers and sisters. It just comes with the package. But brothers and sisters, it's because parents want to do everything. They don't want to miss out, brothers and sisters, on career, nor do they want to miss out, brothers and sisters, on parenthood. Yet they can't do either of those right. Why? Because you just can't. You're either going to be a good parent or you're going to be a good, you know, business person, whatever you're doing, you know, faithful to the company. And it's just the truth, brothers and sisters. I know that it's hard to take, especially if they hear you. If a parent hears you, you know, and then usually around the afternoon when parents are getting home. Now it's different right now because of how just off everything is. But you would see the parents come in. You know, they come in yelling, put on your shoes, put on your coat, it's time to go, we're late, make sure you got this. They're going here, they're going there, brothers and sisters. It's just a big mess. But let me go back to this. The reason I mention that, brothers and sisters, is because we want to serve two masters sometimes. Just like a parent wants to do everything. Okay? And when I say parent, usually I'm looking more, brothers and sisters, at the mother. Right? Because traditionally, brothers and sisters, the mother has that charge of the children. But brothers and sisters, sometimes they want their career too, right? They want to do everything. Brothers and sisters, we want to serve God, but we're busy serving ourselves as well. And this is what the scripture is all about, brothers and sisters. It says, the cares of this world and the deceitfulness of riches and the lust of other things entering in choke the word, and it becomes unfruitful. It becomes unfruitful, brothers and sisters. It doesn't matter what it is. You can take absolutely anything too far. Where it takes too much of your time. It takes up too much of your money. It takes up, brothers and sisters, away from the things of God. It's not wrong, brothers and sisters, that we have a distraction. But to what point do we take it? Right? It's not wrong that you have a hobby or you're a collector or this, you know, other things that you enjoy, brothers and sisters. I believe that it's just the way God made you to be, you know, drawn in certain directions, brothers and sisters. But brothers and sisters, we have a responsibility as Christians. We can't do everything, right? There's only 24 hours in a day, and we only have so many calories to burn. But the cares of this world, the cares of this world, we care for too many things that take too much of our time, brothers and sisters. And it's good when, and you know, I don't know, sometimes it hits you different ways, because I know I have days off where I have so much energy and so many things to do that I'm working hard all day long. And there's other days where I just don't want to do one thing. I just want to relax, right? But brothers and sisters, it's good when we leave time for God. Now, I brought this out in the past, brothers and sisters, when it comes to when you get married, right? When you get married, it takes away from God. That's what the scripture says. That's what Paul teaches. It takes away from God, but he says, that's okay, because I did make you to get married, to have a partner. When you have kids, it takes more of your time now. It takes more time away from your spouse, and it takes time away from God. But God says, that's okay, because I said that was okay. But then, brothers and sisters, we start getting married to other things. We start getting married to our car, and now I've got to work a part-time because of my car. Right? And maybe you don't. But maybe you know, it's something else. And brothers and sisters, and he says, the cares of this world, they just choke you. They choke the word. And you become unfruitful, brothers and sisters. The lusts of other things entering in choke the word. And so we can be distracted by everything around us, brothers and sisters. We can waste time. And you know what, brothers and sisters? Let me just say this, that when you take upon yourself responsibility of having a family, God has a way, brothers and sisters, of stretching the time you have with him. He does that. He has, and I don't know how he does it, but he does it. Because he said it was okay for you to find a lovely, lovely wife and have lovely kids. And he's not going to penalize you. But brothers and sisters, more than that, he says, more than that is sinful. More than that, you need to confess and you need to change your ways. Because it's going to choke the word from your life. Right? And we know, and those are the things, brothers and sisters, that we see and we know, we realize we do wrong, but we remain silent like David did for a little while. And we don't say a thing. And the Lord wants us to change that and make it right. Make it right, because we want to be right with him, brothers and sisters. We need to be in a place where we can hear the voice of God today. Let's not put it off for tomorrow, because things will be upon you faster than you realize, brothers and sisters. Don't leave something that you can do today for tomorrow. Leave it for today, brothers and sisters. Do it today. Take care of it today. Confess it today. Make it right. Because we want to hear the voice of God, brothers and sisters. We want to see, we want to hear wonderful things. We want to hear wonderful things, it says, great and mighty things which thou knowest not. Amen? These are the things we want to hear, brothers and sisters. Wonderful things. Some tough times are gonna come, brothers and sisters, and we're going to be in the middle of it. And we're going to learn so much just from that. And there's other things I have on my mind, brothers and sisters, but we'll just have to hold off. But I appreciate the Lord. I know that some may be thinking, you know, this message, who is it for? I'm not really thinking of anyone in particular, brothers and sisters. But I do think of myself. And I know that I've lived this, brothers and sisters. And I've heard testimonies of others who have passed through this. But brothers and sisters, I believe that there are those that need to hear this. They need to make things right. They need to make things right, brothers and sisters. And I don't know who they are or what it is, but I believe it's there. All right, we'll end here. Let us all stand. Let us pray. Precious Father, Lord, tonight, Lord, it's so strange, Lord, how you sometimes work, but Lord, we just appreciate you, and we thank you for everything. Lord, I just pray that this will reach the ears of those that need to hear it, and those that need to make things right, Lord. Only you know. And you know my heart, Lord. You know that it's not because I heard something or saw something. It's just because this is what I felt to bring up. Lord, we'll lean on you, Lord. Lord, may you just bless each and every brother and sister. There are many that are not here, but Lord, I believe that, Lord, that you are there, you're everywhere, and you're in us. And Lord, and we need you. So may you just bless them, Lord, here today. Bless every brother and every sister, Lord, whether here or not here. Lord, take care of them, Lord. And may you just touch their bodies, Lord. Touch, Lord, their needs, whatever it might be. Lord, we ask it in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen.